But let's get into game two here. Picks and bans. We'll see if Excellence can answer back against Rival.
So first pick going to go in the favor of Excellence. Now, last time, they were the ones that banned Guan Yu. Maybe this time around, they're going to have to switch something up and look to first pick it, but going to stick to their guns and ban it away.
Yeah. Flip Guan Yu. That's what I say. Guan Yu is so annoying, man. And I think everyone kind of agrees with that. Susanoo going to be banned away. So I imagine we'll see Rival take out Ao Kuang again.
More than likely, if we're going to see the similar bans coming out, Excellence just waiting for their next ban. And they're going to have to commit to a strategy and execute accordingly. They had the mindset with the Sobek and Willish, like we mentioned. They just weren't able to execute it. And ever since going behind early on, they couldn't come back into it.
And they're actually going to ban away Bacchus. So feeling that was an issue in the last game. We did see Zinborn play pretty aggressive with it, kind of set up a lot of kills, and then just kind of the god that was so deadly in the battle. Like, it's just like there was so much tankiness on Rival that Bacchus was just a big problem.
So now Rival is going to ban Scylla. Last time, they banned Scylla and picked up the Ryzen. Now Excellence is going to pick up the Ao Kuang for themselves.
Okay, so we'll see how this works out. A god that Excellence kind of want to run off of. No Sobek Awilish combo here. Rival looking to answer back. I would imagine could look at an Athena here if you really want kind of one of those top tier supports. But we have seen, you know, Sobek be pretty highly sought after as well.
It's going to be the Ryzen for Rival this time around. Now, they're going to need an aggressive jungler to pair up with his Ryzen and play very aggressively in the early stages against the Ao Kuang before his damage comes online.
I mean, at the very least, they got an aggressive support and mid. So, two of the three for their core. And Nemesis?
So
okay.
A little bit of a flex for Excellence, whether it's going to be the Ao Kuang or Nemesis in the solo lane. It looks like they have kind of a pocket strategy, and they're going to show it to us here today against Rival.
I'm really excited to see this because we have seen both Nemesis and Ao Kuang go into the solo lane. We've seen Nemesis support, although it's been quite some time. Rival, though, they're going to be looking for pressure in that solo side. They've got the Robin. I would say I honestly think Osiris is better if it's an Ao Kuang solo. Just because you have the guaranteed poke when he sits back.
And the tether will spot him during the water illusion, which is very important.
But I mean, I mean Robin's always safe too, so. You can't go wrong with Robin.
Yana's going to get banned from Rival, whereas Thor, smartly banned away from Excellence, not allowing that kind of global pressure and the bursts for Rival.
Yeah, I feel like Naja might be banned away as well, or maybe a Fenrir, depending on what they think Rival's going to prefer kind of in that jungle role. Jonqui taken out by Rival. That's interesting.
I'm looking more at Hunbats being picked for Rival more than the Fenrir or the Naja, just because of the synergy between the Fear No Evil and the ultimate from Ryzen.
Yeah, just guaranteeing those hits as long as Ryzen can line them up. And they seem to agree with you. Excellence bans away Hunbats. So now Rival going to have the option. They could look for their Hunter and counterpick their jungler, and that's exactly what they're going to do. Apollo locked in.
Pretty good Hunter pick. You can peel for yourself with a Mez, dash away, trying to buy time for the rest of your team with your ultimate if you can get up into the sky. Maybe good for a re-engage as well. Excellence composition is pretty aggressive with this Nemesis Ao Kuang. Like you mentioned, we haven't seen a support Nemesis, but with an Athena, more than likely that's going to go support. So I'm curious to see where those first two picks are going.
And they've got a Soul, which is interesting to me. It seems Excellence have drafted, outside of Soul, who is kind of a mix between kind of that AoE burst, right, and single target. I feel like she's more, even though she has big AoE abilities, I feel like Soul is more of a single target goddess. And then Ao Kuang and Nem, also these very single target oriented gods. So, I mean, when it comes to team fights, it might just go in Rival's favor, right? But if Excellence can get rolling on some picks, it's going to be great.
So, like you mentioned, between the Naja and the Fenrir, Rival are going to try to synergize with this Ryzen aggressively. If anyone gets stunned by the Fenrir, there's going to be a lot of follow-up damage with the Ryzen. Excellence has to take account for that as well. But they have the Athena and the Medusa, which should give them advantage at level 5 in the duel lane with that taunt ultimate.
The Fenrir also a decent counter to Nemesis, considering that he can ult and go CC immune if Nemesis looks to engage on him. Also has the jump as well as the Brutalize. So a fair amount of mobility.
So the thing is, the Fenrir Brutalize is going to continue to chase all of Excellence here. The Athena dash, the dash from Medusa,
Soul.
And the Nemesis.
Yeah, Soul as well. And yeah, it's only going to be Ao Kuang's Water Illusion that can really get outside of that. This Fenrir is a great pick into this composition. We'll see how Excellence can deal with it. It is going to be the Alquang in the solo lane up against the Robin, so kind of what I would have expected coming into this one here. How do you feel about this matchup?
I haven't really seen this matchup in a while. Whenever the Robin was introduced into the solo lane, Alquang kind of fell out of favor in the solo lane. So that's why it's going to be interesting to see, especially in the console league.
Predators, though, I mean, he's been around for a while. Clearing out the minions. Going to start with this Wild Storm here, just so he can clear out all three. Normally, you see kind of the Dragon Call just because it's so much more damage early on. However, 7-second cooldown, can't go wrong with that either. And they're actually going to kind of screw over Predators, I would say.
Well, in a way, it does sacrifice gold for Predators, but he's going to get more solo experience. And Nemesis is starting those right side mid harpies. Meanwhile, the left hand side is being taken by the Ryzen.
And it looks like Herp just getting pressured out here. So it is a Medusa mid that we didn't mention. The Soul going to go over to the dual lane. So it's the Nemesis, Medusa.
It's a good amount of damage as well. Normally, we would see an Athena in the dual lane with a Medusa. However, there's more 3v3 fights in the mid game than there is 2v2s in the dual lane. So in that aspect, it'll synergize better at more stages of the game.
And the Medusa actually not electing to go into Throwing Dagger, instead wants that, you know, kind of giving up the early game to go for that massive power spike with the Transcendence. Once that's online and stacking, you get your boots as well. I mean, that Acid Spray will chunk players, and they're not really expecting it kind of in most situations.
Finding the pluck onto the Soul Mest as well, taking a lot of poke. Oh. Could potentially get engaged on. Sprint was popped as well. Gonna find the dash, gonna slow and dash. It's going to pop a little bit of Stellar Burst damage, but not enough. The body block is just so good from the Sobek.
And there's the taunt. Finally, though, Sobek secures the kill onto Herp the Derp. So First Blood going the way of Rival this time. The rotation's been made by the jungler. There you can see Nemesis going to hit the slow onto the Apollo, but he just dashes away and no follow-up off of the Medusa. And it's going to give pressure to Rival in the mid lane as well.
And that's something that they're also taking advantage of.
No.
They're trying to play aggressively underneath in the jungle side, trying to do a lot of damage to Farley's. And now Farley's can't rotate to get that wave in middle.
And just pushed out. There's nothing to invade outside of the back harpies, but look at this. There's just four members on this left-hand side, and Excellence can't do anything.
This is a beautiful play from Rival.
I mean, that's the thing, is that Excellence drafted, you know, these gods like Alquang and Nemesis that, you know, really excel in late-game scenarios. And Rival are just going to make sure they can't get there.
And now pushing the mid wave again, they're going to more than likely look for another aggressive play in either side lane.
I would imagine, you know, Predators are probably going to get pressured out here. I'm a little bit surprised that Predators isn't as far behind as I would expect them to be in this situation. Only like less than 100 gold. That's really good for this Alquang.
It's going to be a little bit more. He did lose some gold under this tower currently, as there is some rotations from Rival, and there had to been some waves under his own tower from the Alquang just to make sure he wasn't going to get ganked. Because, sure, they could have been Fire Giant Imps, but you never know after what's going to happen after those Imps.
And look at this. I mean, Predator's rooted out. He's going to be forced to Water Illusion away, and he's going to get chased under tower. His ult, he has to use defensively to knock someone up. Actually, I think it was in execute range to finish off Gnome, but he wasn't aware of it.
He just wanted to play safe in that position. There is no purification for the Raven trying to get the teleport online. And a little bit of a missed opportunity for Predators. Even if there wasn't an execute range, just the travel time from going up in the sky would have allowed for additional tower shot, which still would have potentially secured the kill.
But they both managed to back in time just as the buff spawned. So an interesting time frame. Lycan, a little bit slow on the purification, going to get flung back. And there it is. The CC immunity has ended. Rival just going to pick him up there, getting a little bit over aggressive by himself.
Just unfortunately a little slow on the purification during the Sobek pluck, and taking full advantage of that was Rapia, waiting for it to fade away, grabbing the Nemesis into his mouth, and then allowing Atonement to follow up with all his damage.
And look at this on the right-hand side, the invade coming out. Predator's trying to get his blue buff, but I think it's already been stolen away, and Gnome just walks away the victor. Gnome going into the Bluestone instead of the typical death toll, or the potential for the death toll, just to keep the sustain up. But still, Predator's a little bit over-anxious by himself.
Beautiful bait also by Gnome, recognizing the fact that obviously he was getting closer and closer to execute range, and that made it really enticing for this Alquang to just constantly another invade. Unfortunately, didn't go into Headhunter's favor, but going to safely use his ultimate just to disengage from that.
I'm a little bit surprised he went to the mid lane instead of the dual lane. He's going to miss out on a wave there unless he can get back in time. Still, though, Rival, first three kills on the board, already have a 1,500 gold lead. 5 minutes in. I mean, this is pretty massive, but I mean, that's the risk that Excellence has run.
Well, they've gotten all three Fire Giants. They've stolen away the blue buff. They've gotten a majority of these mid Harpies, and getting the first Blood Bounty was really important for them as well. Extending this goal lead at the 5 minute mark, they can easily run away with this, and Excellence needs to adapt very quickly.
And you can see Predators, we didn't really mention it, but he's gone into the Purification, just trying to stay alive, which is interesting. Up against a Robin there, so no teleport, which means the experience and gold farming should go Gnome's favor most of the game. Already has that 500 gold lead.
He's trying to pick up the Purification, wanting to make sure he doesn't get ganked by the Fenrir. Getting under the tower of Rival is very important.
Oh,
now Predators is baiting Gnome this time around.
The ultimate is available from Lycan here. Gnome's going to overhead kick. I mean, a fair amount. He still has his ult, and he's actually going to Mystic Rush on top. Oh, and Lycan, he's going to get traded out there one for one, but Predator's finally on the board there. That's going to be important for him to get back into the match.
I like the mindset there, baiting out the ultimate from Gnome, making sure that there was no way to disengage from Predator's ultimate. However, with the Nemesis ultimate, Nemesis double dashing into the tower, there was nowhere for her to escape afterwards.
And, I mean, I'd still say that's overall a win, though, right? Obviously, Lycan gets behind, but he was already behind, and this kind of catches Predators up at least a little bit, so he's not just kind of getting completely destroyed by the Robin there, who can snowball and steal away his buffs on cooldown.
Because Ao Kuang late game is definitely certainly better than the Nemesis, so trading off a little bit on your jungle side, benefiting your soul laner, and then from here on out, the Ao Kuang could potentially look for more solo plays as a result.
And we saw him getting pretty close to killing some people. We have a fight in the mid lane here, Lycan getting zoned out, and it's going to be Farley's the first to fall. Taunt on a Mr. Turtle as well, and he's going to be picked up, and he actually has Purification. Going to be able to dash away, but Gnome, trying to line up that pluck there, but thought better of it when he saw the Nemesis around the corner. That ult surely would have spilled his death.
It would have been, but looking at the ultimate, it is up, so that would have been taking a lot of damage from the Nemesis ulti from two or three tower shots, as well as being slowed. So smart discipline coming out of Zenborn.
And now still, Rival grouped up in the mid lane here. And Mr. Turtle sitting underneath, Predator's very low. He's gonna actually pop his Water Illusion early. Ultimate online for Gnome, but doesn't elect to dive. Probably would have been a free kill on that one.
Especially with Predator's not having his ultimate up until just now. The timing window was missed a little bit there. And now Rival is gonna look for this speed buff invade, having the advantage, the fact that Predator's did get poked out.
And once again, no teleport, so it's gonna take a while for Predator's to get back in. He's gonna be losing his blue buff as well, probably some minions in the wave. Things are not going good for this Ao Kuang right now. I mean, I think it's simply the fact that they put low pressure in the mid jungle and solo, so there's just so much invade. There's just so much invade potential.
And now Rival are up about 3,500 gold, close to the 8 minute mark, extending their lead ever so slightly. Right side mid Harpies being taken for them as well as Excellence grabbing their own red buff. Duelane was considering maybe starting up Gold Fear, but just going to wait for the right timing.
And now a 3K gold lead coming out for Rival. They're going to keep trying to extend it. Rotation here onto Herp. And there's the dash forward. Activates to separate and the Purification. So 160 second cooldown that Rival are going to be able to abuse if they want to look for a gank there, especially onto this Fenrir.
That's really important to get Purification. Not even using your ultimate, just using a basic ability like Mesmerize. It just goes to show you how strong that ability really is, especially when you have your support with you to follow that up.
The double baits, look at this. Lycan waiting around the corner, but he doesn't realize that the Fenrir's there as well. He's going to get stunned, and he's going to get chased down as well. There's the ult, Force Purification. He's going to get stunned, activate his ult, but it doesn't matter. Can't even get his dash off in time. Predator's trying to make something happen. He dashes. He does have one execute range, but he's getting hit on by the archers, and Rapio takes him out 2-0. Finally, though, should be traded out thanks to Farley's rotation.
And now there's going to be more aggression. There's a rotation from Zenborn as
well. Not under
the dash has followed Medusa under the tower, ultimate being procced just to disengage from Rapio. So the disengage from Farley's, he's going to be losing some more golden experience, not being able to farm the way he needs to.
And look at the splitting of waves. We actually have a rotation from Apollo in the meantime, as we saw the Ryzen under base, and he's going to be able to get this tier one tower unless the Nemesis can stop him in time, but he's only level 8. I don't think it's going to happen.
Soul coming from the side, doing a little bit of damage. Dash coming in, and it's going to take out the Ryzen ultimate being connected. There is no relic being used. The Disapparate is going to proc the immunity for now. Apollo could potentially dive this.
Don't actually do it. I was just kidding. He's not able to trade it out. Actually, no. Did he get an auto off before he died?
He might have gotten an auto off. There was no archers in range to confirm that kill. 1-for-1 in the mid lane. But it's going to favor Rival a little bit because they're just going to be waiting for the aggression from Excellence. Predators come from the backhand side. Zanborn a little bit low. Could it be executed potentially?
Oh, gets Zalt off in time, but he should fall here eventually. And it is Lycan to finish him off. Rotation from Finry here. Going to find a stun on Lycan under tower. Switches attention over to Predators. And Predators has nothing to get away from this. Water Illusion still on cooldown for a couple more seconds. He needs the last in hand. But Predators knocks him up. And he jukes out the jump as well. Still surviving, running around in a circle. And he's going to finally get the Water Illusion off.
The Ragnarok not able to connect with any target in the mid lane. Just so disengaged after finding the Sobek into the mid lane. Good disengage from Excellence, but they're not going to be able to get anything as a response, and that's going to hurt them.
Honestly, this could be a Gold Fury, too. You can see it started up. The rotation from Sol is coming. Apollo walks straight to it. So, I mean, that has to give Excellence some frame of mind of what's happening, and Herp finally going to recognize it. It's at 20%, and this could be an option for a steal, but it's a little bit too late. Gold Fury picked up by Rival.
Rival securing themselves a Gold Fury around the 10.5 minute mark, extending their lead to about 4,000 gold. Experience at 6,000, which is huge at this point.
And we're seeing these couple levels across the board, and it's only going to keep extending if Rival keep up the pressure, right? They don't want to let their foot off the gas at the moment. Honestly, it's been a pretty good job by Predators to negate a lot of the aggression that Robin should have had. I feel like this Robin should have been so much further ahead, and there's been so many close battles. Just in that mid lane there, he helps find a kill and jukes out for so long, just continuously baiting the Rival team.
The one-for-one trade earlier in the Tier 1 Tower of Gnome was really important for Predators to allow him to catch up a little bit. But now, the later this game goes, the more it's going to favor Excellence because of that Alquang. So Rival needs to utilize their golden experience lead to their advantage, constantly finding the speed buff and blue buff invades that they were doing earlier on. But because they were low after that Gold Fury, they had to kind of reset, and the timing didn't allow them to do so.
Still, though, they're starting to get these item leads. You can see Doom Orb finished and starting to be stacked up by the Raijin. Rapio going to find a stun on Farley's. Oh, and there's no way he's going to make it out of this one. And there comes the Raijin ult as well, looking for the taunts, but can't connect. Splits the uprights between Mr. Turtle and Lycan, but Lycan still flung back in the late purification once again. Thundercrash aggressively. There's no way he's getting out. It should be Zinborn to finish him off, but instead, Zinborn's going to be looking at Turtle. Apollo's in the sky. Mr. Turtle surrounded, but it seems like the team's just looking for the tower. They're trying to play for the objectives.
They need to play for the objectives and control the mid-map, as we do have a rotation from Predators trying to defend. Oh. Going to Water Illusion away as the Tier 2 tower does fall. Rival securing themselves another tower.
It seems like Rapio wanted to go in there, but instead respecting it. There is the tower on the right-hand side that could be low, and look at this. The Headhunter, he's got his own team's red buff. He's going to be stealing away this one as well. The Soul's making the rotation here, but with the Audacity passive activated, he won't get there in time.
Secured, and now four members of Rival trying to get this Tier 1 tower on the right-hand side. It's only Predators currently to be able to defend this, and this Tier 1 tower has to be conceded. Zenborn going to tank it up before the minions even hit there. Soul on the left-hand side needs to maybe look for a play against this Apollo, but he's three levels behind.
Yeah, there's absolutely no way the Soul's going to be able to take this guy out. I mean, he's got the Dynasty Plate helm and the boots, but the Apollo's got a little bit of lifesteal. And look at that. That's Apollo going aggressive, but he took a fair chunk of health that he's got to be a little bit wary of. And you can see Predators right now is topping the damage charts, but just can't make anything happen off of it.
Just has to wait for the right timing. That timing is going to be in about 10 to 15 minutes once he gets a few more items online. Trying to finish off the Polynomicon currently. Should be going into the Soul Reaver later on, and that's going to allow him to find the targets that he needs to execute.
The thing is right now that it's kind of this weird thing where you lose pressure because your Tier 1 tower is down, but I also feel like it's better for this. I feel like you're going to be safer, right? Because you're farming more towards your Tier 2, which means it's going to be dangerous for the Robin to push up by himself. So he's probably going to be a little bit more timid at doing it.
As long as you're last hitting and making sure that all the waves are coming closer and closer to your wave. So now, if somebody wants to come into that solo lane, they're going to have to extend closer to your Tier 2 tower.
And you got the Alquang execute as well, as long as Predators can stay alive. So maybe a little bit more deadly. But not enough gold yet to finish off that Polynomicon that he wants ever so much here. Red buff, the timer, maybe not known by the Athena, kind of sitting around there.
So with the solo lane tower and mid towers being down, the focus from Rival is going to be along the dual lane side, making sure they're going to get this Tier 1 tower.
And this should be free. Herp's going to throw out a little bit of poke, but not going to be enough to dissuade. And Farley's actually looking to split push. You could see that Robin is making a rotation over into the mid lane to help defend, but the Tier 1's already going to be picked up.
Tier 2 is going to be the next target for Rival. Stellar Burst doing a little bit of damage to Atonement. Athena is looking for a taunt. Going to find two targets. Nemesis ulti onto one. Ragnarok being used in the backhand line, setting up the Raja for a lot of damage. Nemesis shielding, surviving against the Brutalize.
Oh, actually, Zinborn walks under the tower by himself in the back line, though you can see the aggression for Predator's rotation. He doesn't have enough damage to finish one off, but Zinborn just walked into the tower at like 5% health by himself, just straight tanked it up.
And with that Headhunter, he forced to use a Sanctuary, making sure he wasn't going to fall to that Tier 2 tower shot. Really good recognition. Mr. Turtle trying to proc.
Predator, he has ult, he has ult, he has ult, and he's going to find it. And there's the knockup, the heal as well. The fight's actually swinging back in Excellence's favor, but they've already dropped the tower. Predators is going to go back in, but I mean, that's so risky. Still managed to get out on top. 1-0, and the rotation from the Athena as they try and look at the Fenrir. All her beads is a couple more autos. With the help of Lycan, it's going to be a 3-2 in favor of Excellent.
It's actually a 4-2 as Zenborn has just respawned now, and Gnome is going to be potentially the next target if Lycan can find the ultimate, which he does. And the rest of Excellence needs to follow up. With an Athena taunt, Stellar Burst is still on cooldown, but doesn't matter. Gnome falls, and that's technically a D-side.
And delayed, but it is there. Goldfear going to be spawning here in just a couple seconds, and Excellence are going to have to pick that one up. The Apollo is up with ult in 5 seconds, so this isn't the freest Goldfury. Turtle's backing. He's going to be able to ult back in, but Zenborn's already making the rotation.
The ultimate from Zenborn is not available quite yet.
They need to commit. Apollo's in the sky.
He needs to find the disruption. He needs to get in there and tail flip, maybe forcing somebody to disengage. Lurking in the water is used. It's going to have to be disengaged by Excellence.
Oh, now Lycan, very low. Gold Fury is secured by Excellence here, but they need to be careful. Otherwise, they could get this fight turned on them. No, it's just going to be Zenborn left by himself. Lycan trying to chase back in, but he's so low, so he'll back off, and Predators can't make anything happen either. But Excellence get the Gold Fury, neutralize a little bit of those towers that Rival had already pushed.
I would have liked to see Zenborn using his abilities before going into the ultimate form, because then the duration of lurking in the waters would allow his abilities to come off cooldown afterwards. So a little bit of a missed opportunity there.
Maybe they can kill Lycan in that situation, but that's not what happens. Rival still in the lead by about 5,000 to 6,000 gold. 5,500, I was correct. Right in the middle.
It's always in the middle.
Need like a little bit more to get exactly right now. Dang. But the Predator's starting to become deadly. He's got the Polynomicon online. We saw him pick up 2 kills, trade himself out there in that last engagement.
Looks like he's going to build into the Obsidian Shard. Nice dash from Medusa, making sure no aggression coming from the Fenrir.
And 17 minutes in. This has actually been a whole lot of fighting. It feels like this game should be a little bit later, but that's just the kind of flow of the game where everyone wants to fight here. Predators still probably not going to be able to deal with Gnome for some while, but I mean, his damage on the squishy targets is going to be so impactful. You can see 9k for him, only below his own soul.
As long as he's patient also during these team fights, doesn't matter if he does the damage, but it is going to matter if he gets picked off in that situation. He has no wards, unfortunately, in his jungle side, and without having a tier 1 tower, even if he did have a tier 1 tower, it wouldn't have mattered. It would not have allowed him to escape in that scenario.
And look at this. You could see the group up from Rival. They know that there's only one tower left that they need to take. And with that pick on a Predators, I mean, it's going to be a pretty good fight for them. Apollo split pushing in the meantime, going to be able to put the soul in the middle lane to deal with him unless they want to risk giving up a Phoenix here. But all four members of Rival pushing in, and Excellence have to drop it.
And that's going to extend the goal lead for Rival just a little bit further. And with that Tier 2 tower, Rival is going to maybe force a Fire Giant.
I mean, you could just see. I mean, that's really risky at this point. I mean, we're only 18 minutes in. There's not enough damage on Rival to just straight up do it. And they're probably going to get heavily poked out here. But, I mean, Excellence need to recognize this is happening sooner rather than later.
And they're coming around the corner. Nemesis and Athena are leading the charge. Zenborn going to try to zone.
They're committing.
Going to try to have to look for a plug. Fire Giant at about 30% health. The Athena is going to get plugged and turned on instantly, taking a little bit of poke. Raijin ultimate being used, but forces Sanctuary away. A lot of damage was being dealt. Now, it looks like Lycan has to disengage. Mr. Turtle's in a little bit of trouble as there is a rotation for Predators finding the kill onto Atonement.
Predator's the one to watch here. I mean, he's going to have to be the one that turns this in favor. He's going to come down, be looking for Rapio. Great Sanctuary from Rapio. Keep him in alive for now. And now Predators is on full retreat. No water illusion. He is going to pop the purification, just trying to make sure to preemptively stop it, and he stuns, and he is going to be able to turn on to Fenrir. Athena ult lands down, and there's the three-man taunt. Lycan's around the corner trying to help out his support, but he's going to get turned on by Gnome, and it looks like he is probably going to take a fall unless Farley stops it.
And it looks like the Sanctuary was used from Lycan deterring away Gnome from chasing the kill. So overall, that was about a 2-for-1 exchange in the favor of Excellence. Beautiful plays coming out of Predator's make. Even though he fell, he was a staple of that team fight.
I mean, honestly, Rival at that point probably could have either just committed to the Fire Giant because it's under 20%, although it's really risky because you do open yourself up to those kind of post-FG fights, even if you do secure it. But I mean, with the Ryzen ult, you can just press the either the taunt or the fear button and force anyone who tries to steal it off of it.
You could secure it with a Ryzen ulti, but it's not a similar story of having a Giannis on your side to allow yourself to disengage after the Fire
That's
Giant.
That's true.
You do have a sprint for the Sobek, but is that going to be enough to deal with the aggression from Excellence that are going to be trying to hunt you down afterwards? There is a blink from this Ao Kuang also.
Yeah, the Relic style for Rival last game was, I think, 2 meditations, 2 sprints, and a shell. It was like really teamfight oriented, but now a little bit greedier where they only have, you know, one of each of those, a single med, a single sprint, and a shell, and everyone else kind of going into those purification sanctuary to keep them alive.
So a lot of aggression, 11 to 14 at the 20-minute mark at this stage of the game. Rival extending their lead to a little bit, about 6,000 gold, forcing a fight onto Predators, caught a little bit out of position, not having purification available, taken full advantage of.
Predators is definitely the one that Rival need to target out in these fights. I mean, he's just probably keeping the team in it for now. He's reaching that point where the late game Ao Kuang, while it's not there, it's getting close, and we're seeing him burst these squishy targets and get off these executes. However, Fire Giant started up Turtle, rotating around, and this time it doesn't look like they're trying to bait a fight. They're actually fully committing to it. There's the Ryzen ult looking to secure, and it's trying to be stolen away, and it actually is stolen away and secured by Farley's ult, I think.
That was perfectly done. However, Herp the Derp in a little bit of trouble. He's going to fall pluck onto Lycan. That could be the second target, but nice taunt from Mr. Turtle. And meanwhile, on the backhand side, Farley's in trouble. Rapio going to find the kill as Apollo comes crashing down. But Lycan's in a lot of trouble too, getting stunned out by Unchained.
Yeah, Lycan actually dashes into the team there. And I mean, they don't really care about this Athena damage. Honestly, they should probably just chase through. There it is. And now it's just Turtle surrounded by 5. Predators has respawned. He's level 18. And if he's going to make something happen, it's got to be now. He's got a couple in execute range, but he can't close the distance. And it seems like they've healed up just enough to stay strong. Water Illusion almost killing Zinborn thanks to the Phoenix as well. And it's going to be hard for Rival to get into this one. I mean, Predators, he needs to play this perfectly, but he does have his blink up. He does have his purification as well. He could definitely finish someone off here.
He misses his 3, having the damage. And now it's Homan trying to find the aggression. The Water Illusion being used.
Oh, he popped it early.
That's it. Predators is done. And now this mid-Phoenix is going to fall. There's no way Mr. Turtle can hold this 1v4.
And the Phoenix is take it away, Rival. They're just going to reset, it seems. They don't want to risk going for any more Phoenixes, but Predators, I mean, he just played that all sorts of wrong. Had his blink, missed his Wildstorm, popped his Water Illusion early while he was in invincibility, where he probably could have gotten out if he saves it.
Just a little bit of lack of execution, unfortunately. He has to be very precise. You are a late game mage assassin. You need to land all these abilities to get somebody into execute range and snowball a teamfight in your favor. Considering the fact that your team just stole Fire Giant, you need to be able to come back into this game.
And Turtle, the only player with Fire Giant still around his waist. All in all, that was probably good for Excellence, right? They do get wiped. They only lose a single Phoenix, and they keep Fire Giant out of the hands of Rival. And it seems like they're going to get Gold Fury uncontested as well.
That's true, because if Rival had gotten that Fire Giant, more than likely all 3 Phoenixes would have fallen. So instead, only losing one is a huge win for Excellence.
What is Herp doing? He's by himself. I mean, his team's getting Gold Fury. He's all pushed up. And his disapparate form is going to end. And you can see Turtle trying to peel for him, but Turtle's only going to put himself into an awkward spot. He's going to get rooted up by Gnome, and he's going to fall too. And honestly, Soul might have just baited a guaranteed loss there.
That's 2 members down on the side of Excellence. Rival with a 5-on-3. Fire Giant is still down for about 2.5 minutes or so. So this is going to be a right side Phoenix once this wave comes closer.
And the question is, are Rival going to push it? And they're just going to strip away the jungle for now. And yeah, the call is, let's focus it. Let's focus up. We're 24 minutes in. We've got a significant gold lead and an item up. So let's push it here. Zinborn off the mark on the pluck.
just waiting for the right timing. Blink from Predators on the back line. The Raijin ultimate is just going to shred Predators. And now Rapio is diving the back line, picking up Farley's, and that's going to be a kill even before the Medusa ultimate. And Lycan falling, that's going to be a deicide. This Titan is exposed.
And now Fire Minion is kind of raining down the mid. The spawn is through for Turtle and Herp the Dirt, but it's 2v5. It's going to be very hard for them to defend, and swinging away, it's going to be Rival here. There should come out on top. The Titan, it's under 50% there, and it's going to be finished off finally as Rapio takes out Herp. Somehow Turtle survives another fight, but overall, I mean, Excellence, they definitely look solid. There's just a couple decisions, and I think their picks and bans, they put themselves in a spot where it was very hard for them to win. If they could hold out for the Aokwang, yeah, sure.
So with that win, Rival currently are tied with Barrage. They did split earlier, so if Rival pick up this win, they're going to be ahead of Barrage, and now Excellence are currently 4-4.
Yeah, I think we have a clear separation of power here. Barrage and Rival were the two teams we expected to be at the top, and they've traded out their equal records. Excellence seemed to be better than Excel, but I do like Excellence and Excel. They're not, you know, kind of just getting completely dominated by these other teams. It is they are very close matches, at least for the first 15 to 20 minutes.
And we've seen progress from both Excel and Excellence's between their first 2 weeks. Atonement playing just really well, dodging out the Sobek ultimate and then counter-engaging. They used their strategy of the counter-engage just so perfectly, Rival, and then utilizing their objective invades afterwards.
Yeah, I loved Atonement's playing style here. Even his build, you can see he gets flung straight to the back line, immediately gonna pop his ultimate and just do so much damage to the team. Picks up a double kill here. I think Farley's does manage to make it out. But even on the Raijin here in this second game, just his positioning was on point.
And the way he used that Jean-Cui also, he backstepped just to get off more people on his second ability, just doing a lot of damage, maximizing every little ability that he can.
And right there, also isolating the soul. Even though the Fire Giant was stolen away, he didn't waste any time. He didn't, you know, hang his head. The call was, all right, we did lose this Fire Giant, but let's go all the way in. We have a member on the line, though. It is the Jungler. How are you doing, Rapio?
Hey, guys. What's up?
What's going on? So how does it feel to be 5-1 tied for first right now?
Oh, it's good. We're pretty confident going into the rest of the split that we're going to end top two right now. Not
awesome.
To sound cocky, but we're pretty happy.
All right. Talk to me a little bit about game one, because we felt your core draft was pretty strong, kind of that anti-Sobek's Aweelix. Were you guys looking for or thinking about the same thing?
We spent quite a long time analyzing their drafts for the last few games and realized what they were going to try and go for. So we ended up thinking that if we just draft tankiness, they won't be able to do anything against us. So what we ended up going for.
So your next opponent is going to be Excel, and then it's going to be Barrage. Which opponent are you looking forward to facing more? And what kind of is there anything that you want to talk about between those two teams and matchups?
We're looking forward to both games, obviously. We enjoy every game we play. The Barrage game, though, we always look forward to those. It's like a little rivalry we've got going on right now. Barrage are incredible team, so it'll be a good game.
So you talked a little bit about draft analysis. How much effort do you guys put into that? Is it more, you know, focusing on the scrims or more kind of thinking about the meta for you guys?
Well, we just recently started talking to an analyst we got called Squeaky G, and he's been helping a ton with what we're doing. And we mainly just... We look at what we want to do and try out in scrims, and then we just put it in the back pocket for when we need to bring it out. So we
could see some more interesting strategies here coming up in the next couple weeks, is what you're saying.
Oh, yeah.
Definitely. All right, I'm excited. So game two, though, you went on to the Fenrir. What was kind of your goal of this match, right? Because you did have that Aokwang solo. Did you put any attention over to him, or was it more kind of just invade as much as possible?
Well, after we saw the Nemesis and Aokwang, we just wanted to draft as much early pressure as we could. So we left the jungle pick later on because there was quite a few options open anyway. And then it was just a matter of shutting down the mid and then taking speed and red on cooldown when we could.
Were you also thinking about the dashes on the side of Excellence for picking up the Fenrir, being able to chase out the Nemesis Medusa?
Oh yeah, as soon as the Medusa got locked in, I knew exactly what I was going for there.
100%. Yeah, awesome. It really seemed to pay off there. Definitely some intelligence, I think, in your drafting strategy. It really gave you guys the edge in this one. Before we let you go, though, any shout-outs you want to give?
Shout-outs to my team. They're amazing, guys. And shout-outs to Team Rival and everyone watching. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you, Rapio.
Thank you, Rapio.
Just a quick reminder, guys. I know that we've talked about it a fair amount, but, I mean... There is a lot of changes coming to the SPL. We're going to be having a show next Wednesday, July 6th, 4 p.m. Eastern. You're not going to watch, not going to want to miss watching that. It's going to go over everything. And I think we have a fair number of things that people are going to be excited about.
I'm excited.
You're excited?
I'm super excited. I can't wait. I'm eager.
You're eager. No, you're a caster now. You can't. That's against the rules. Can't have bias. Anyways, though, that's going to be it for us today, guys. We do have the Joust 3v3 going on tomorrow. It's going to be taking place every weekend, July 2nd to the 31st. That's my birthday.
31st.
Hey, twitch.tv/highracetv, and we're going to be doing it a little bit of a different style. It's going to be pretty casual. We're going to be on the couch here. Tolly and I will actually be joined by Scott Gandhi for the opening day, and we might be trying to get in as many guests as possible throughout, so make sure to tune in tomorrow, guys. You're not going to want to miss that one, but that's going to be it for the SCL today. Once again, the 3v3 Joust this weekend. We also have makeup games on Monday from the server issues last week, so for myself, Tolly, the rest of the casters and the production staff, and of course, I've missed him, Peckies.
We love Peckies.
Anyways, have a good day, guys. Enjoy your weekend.